the noise that's made isn't simultaneous. How does that help you?
So for me, what I will say is that because I don't typically deal in video, I cheat a lot. Where I will align tracks either correctly or incorrectly. Because, like, I run a comedy hobby cast. That's, like, my bread and butter. We do, like, book reviews or whatever. And if a joke didn't land and I can just delete it and then, like, move the tracks around so they're happy, I will do that. Like, I got no shame. And that'll include, like, if it takes, like, a solid couple of seconds for my co-host to get the joke or whatever, I'll just scooch it on over, you know? I'll just make it sound like... So for me, like, there's a lot of chopping up and kind of rearranging. And I honestly don't know how that works on video.
Okay.
Like, I don't know. Because on video, like, I don't know if you can take 3 seconds of me being like, ha, 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 and, like, take that out. I don't know if it works.
Well, this
that
has
way.
Been my issue. I'm dabbling in so many different tools. But before mm-hmm. we get into all this tech stuff, I love the titles you brainstormed for the episode. But the one that resonated with me the most is, like, loving media.
Loving media that don't love you back.
There
for
you
sure.
Go.
Yeah.
Because that's an ongoing theme, I think, for a lot of people, especially like J.K. Rowling's a perfect example. I am a little bit older than most of the people who are like madly in love with her work. Mm-hmm. But a lot of grown people read it too, but still, but just being disappointed or getting that gut punch from somebody who you thought created a universe where you could escape into mm-hmm. and then finding mm-hmm. out that like they literally don't see you, they don't get you, like somehow they're just out of sync with any of your marginalized identities, that sort of thing. And that's happened so many different times. And even though I love Stephen King, he's had a couple of problematic quotes.
Ooh, baby. Ooh, Stephen King. Yeah, it's interesting because Stephen King is, I think, kind of typical of a lot of people in his generation. So he's a very early boomer. He can remember going and getting these like really typical 1950s cultural touchstones, which is why like Western tropes show up a lot in his media, like gangster hard-boiled tropes show up a lot in his media. But it also means that a lot of this cultural baggage from this very explicitly racist, sexist, homophobic time kind of bleeds through. And I think it's oftentimes the best and the worst thing about Stephen King, for me, like for what I read for, right? Like, which is that sometimes he will take these tropes and use them unquestioningly. Mm. And that's always disappointing. Where you're like, okay, like we really, like we read The Green Mile again this year. And like, it's a rough time to be reading The Green Mile. Because, like, it is just the magic Negro trope. And it's, like, so painful to be like, well, you know, they literally sneak this character out of jail so that he can perform magic and save a dying white woman. And then they bring him back to jail so that he can be executed. And it's like, you can just leave him out of jail. Like,
explain it like that, that is just like, yes,
so,
yes.
But then there are times when he really thoughtfully questions these tropes and these kind of handed down media expressions. One that I really is controversial, especially among like queer Stephen King fans, is Stephen King's It, which is one of his most iconic works by a country mile, right? It's the sprawling fantasy horror epic. One of the touchstone moments of horror in that work, both in the movie adaptations and in the book itself, is a hate crime. There's a gay man who gets horribly, brutally murdered and thrown off of a bridge. And what's fascinating about it is that it's a cultural touchstone for Mainers of his generation because it represents an actual hate crime that occurred and that shocked a lot of people into understanding that queer people are in a lot of danger, like all the time.
Right.
And he ties it to the evil force that is Pennywise. And Pennywise is interesting because he's a generational evil. He comes back every 27 years. And there's this recurrent unthinking evil theme that comes up a lot in Stephen King's work. And I personally find it very compelling to tie that kind of like, this bad thing keeps happening over and over and over again for no good reason. Mm. To tie that to the way that people feel about queer people is a really powerful metaphor for me, to say like, it is objectively evil what has happened here. Like, evil in a way that is literally monstrous. And so for me, like, there are these two worlds that exist in Stephen King and broadly in all horror, where it can draw specific lines in the sand in a way that not a lot of other genres can do. Like, it's not afraid to say, this is a monster, right?
Yeah, this is monstrous. That's a really good point. Yes, like, it's interesting because I'm so used to just from living in a very white-centered world, I'm so used to consuming media made by cis-het white men.
Yep.
And it's only now that the gatekeepers are largely gone and there's so much media I can consume created by a variety of people that I'm getting a little less patient or tolerant with constantly seeing things through that lens. Because even and I watched the first remake, not the sequel yet. I wasn't sure if I was like ready because I was kind of disappointed by the first one. I mean, some of just compared to how terrifying it was to watch the original, I was like,
this is the Tim Curry.
I'm like, somehow this isn't scary enough. Even that poor baby's murder at the beginning was still less scary in this one. Or maybe I've changed. I don't know. Because some of the acting in the first one.
I think a lot of it's nostalgia. Because if you go back and rewatch the original now, it feels hopelessly campy.
The acting's pretty weak.
We don't let movies be campy in that way anymore. We just don't. It's not allowed. Like, it's been outlawed.
I think maybe it's Tim Curry too. Like, Tim Curry, there's something about him.
Yeah, so I love Tim Curry's performance in that because it embraces the fact that he's absurd, right? Like, they don't try to make him a cool monster.
Right.
They just put a man in a clown suit and say, all right, mess around up there for a bit. Like, just, like, there's something about the way he commits to it, the way he commits to just being, like, evil and angry in that part that just works.
He just really seems to radiate that causing pain is absolutely delicious to him. And it really comes across and you really buy it and you're like, just the horror of knowing that there are people and there are forces out there that love to cause pain and to be powerful and to have that penchant for causing suffering is like, it's very disturbing. And it is true, like, depending on your identities, it really kind of hits different than maybe it does for other people who feel safe all the time in their day-to-day life. But there's something about how in the remake, the black kid being bullied, just there's something about the way it is shared that falls flat. Like, it just feels like this came through a white lens. Like,
what, a like, Stephen King adaptation made by a major publisher through a white lens? No. Impossible.
Exactly. But I do, it's still nice to get to lose yourself in someone else's world. So I do like that. I remember in a film class I took like a million years ago, one of the things that the professor focused on was how different people experience film in different ways. And especially if you're used to your story not being told,
right?
Especially queer people have developed this ability to see themes that other people don't see or to experience a movie in a way that resonates, even if that isn't the major theme in the movie. Mm. Like, we will find queerness.
It's so funny you bring that up. We're going through in the podcast all of his novels, his bestsellers, in chronological order, and we're reviewing them. And our next one is one of his short story collections, which I love, the delightful little spooky little bite-sized stories. And he writes there's a short story in Everything's Eventual that is very much in the, like, gangster, hard-boiled, like so I says to Johnny, like, that kind of genre. And it's really interesting to me because the text should make me really mad in that there's a lot of casual homophobia in it. Mm. But it's also the most, like, homoerotic story, like, ever. Like, it's these three, like, gangster dudes who've never, like, they met in prison and... like, they've never met anyone who gets them the way that each other gets them. And I'm like, you're gay. Like, I'm sorry. I don't make the rules. Like, the fact that the most important person in your life is another man and you never think to leave his side, like, pretty gay, dude. Like,
well, it's so interesting. Yeah, those themes, those blurred lines with friendship and what is the difference. And I see that all the time. In films that really show how obsessively close teenage girls will get and how they, like,
Yeah, I just watched Booksmart the other day, and Lady Bird is in the same vein.
Yes,
like,
yes. Even, like, that movie, was it Sabrina's Body or Samantha's Body or Jennifer's Body?
Jennifer's Body is
all over the place with the
name. Renaissance right now, yes. Because when it came out, we were just not having these conversations around horror and representation in the same way. In that time period, we were really in, like, the Michael Bay is king kind of world of filmmaking. And Jennifer's Body came out and it did something interesting in that a lot of its horror was subtextual, and the horror was not in that place in that time period. I want to say, like, the big grossing horror movies of that time period was, like, Saw and these other kind of, like...
I can't deal. I'm not into that type of grotesque, not...
Right.
It's not terrifying. It's just gross.
It's like, violent and uncomfortable in that way.
Yeah.
For sure.
Yeah.
There's a lot of, like, academic, like, theoretical, whatever, around those things corresponding with kind of the era in America where we were dealing with, like, whether or not torture is okay. Like, the rise of that genre reflected kind of a period in American history where we were looking at, like, how we treat prisoners of war. And there's some weird parallels. Horror always does this. It's one of my favorite things about the genre, where you can trace what people are uncomfortable with in any given time period, and horror always comes out the gates swinging. You know, it's not a coincidence that Get Out was, like, this landmark piece of film, because, you know, hands down, great genre film, great just, like, film, right? Beautifully written, beautifully shot. That movie predates this kind of countrywide conversation we're having around, like, what is it to be colorblind? What is it to not examine, as especially, like, liberal white people?
Yes.
Like, what is their role in complicity in a racist system? And it's not a coincidence that horror went there first. And, you know, Jordan Peele knows this.
Excellent point. And that, literally, before you said it, as you were explaining that the film reflects what's going on around us, absolutely, that's the first thing that came to my mind. And what I loved about that movie too was just the feeling that I wasn't just seeing something through a different lens for once, but it was like, oh, this is such a familiar lens.
That's the fascinating thing about it.
Yes, because I feel like a million times, even the way his friend interacts with him at the end, he was suspicious of it in the beginning, you know, that is so, so relatable, because when you look at our history in this nation, especially in how we relate to Black people, some of the things that Black Americans have been subjected to, it sounds like fiction. It does not seem real.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
Then if you haven't really looked at that history or thought about it, or
like,
just been raised hearing about it, don't believe it.
Yeah.
And it all sounds so fantastical to you. So at first he seems like a conspiracy theorist and he seems ridiculous. And guess what? He's totally right. And you just can absolutely relate. Yes, this is, it's just bizarre.
That's the central, like, and not to be like a total pretension. Can I swear on your show? Am I allowed to?
Absolutely. I'm thinking right. I'm just going to mark some episodes yeah. explicit because I just can't resist it sometimes.
not to be like that asshole, but like the catharsis of horror, like the thing that's satisfying about it is that I told you so moment. It's the kind of opposite of the don't go in there. It's the I told you not to go in there. Right, like the like you did something that was profoundly stupid, and in Get Out, the thing that was profoundly stupid was like trusting this white family like at all.
Yeah, going out. Dude's
like, don't
go
out there. Like, don't do it. You don't know these people. Like,
well, that's, I think, a moment, funny, you know, too. Like the concept of turning a blind eye to microaggressions again and again and again. How it is mm-hmm. harmful to you. It is a form of violence against you, and tolerate yeah. that at your own peril. So that right. to me was another theme, and it. You're so right in that it predates this major civil rights movement we're going through right now, even though, you know, there's always little tremors before
signs
the major
times.
Movement,
yeah.
right?
Yeah.
And so we were already in this process, but Jordan Peele's fascinating to me because he's a biracial kid, so he has a different,
yeah,
a really nuanced relationship with race as yeah. is. So that's interesting to see that for once, because you don't hear a lot from multiracial people, certainly not multiracial people that are, I don't want to like say woke, but just a little more conscious and really right. thinkers, you know, and a little bit ahead of their time.
Yeah, I mean, it's not often that people who look like Jordan Peele looks are allowed to be major forces in their industry. And it's a testament to the amount of work that this dude has put in mm-hmm. and the amount that he has said, you know, I'm not going to compromise. You know, this is art and this is how I'm going to deal with it. And it's about time. Like we,
yes.
you know, what's interesting to me is that there's this oversimplification of representation in media that happens a lot. And I think this is true of queer writers as well, where we have this sense that the history of any genre or any style of writing, because what we are given, handed down, you know, in our educational system, in our culture, is predominantly from like a straight white male perspective. There's this temptation to say, oh, no one's ever done this before. But that's not true. Like, there have been powerful Black and queer voices in genre fiction for as long as genre fiction has existed. It's just that we don't get to see those lineages as clearly as we get to see like your Poes and your Lovecrafts, because we weren't allowed to, right? Like, it's part of the suppression.
Excellent point. Like, where do you start? So when you think of queer voices that have meant a lot to you, how do you go about discovering them when for so long they're not featured?
Yeah, I mean, it's tough, right? And I think a lot of it does come back to, as you mentioned, like reading into queer themes in media that isn't necessarily coded queer. So like for me, you know, I'm a horror nerd. I've always it's been in my blood since day one. I can't explain it. It's just part of who I am. And so for me, a really early kind of literature reference point was Bram Stoker's Dracula. Mm. And there's a lot of sexuality in Dracula, and there's a lot of homoeroticism in Dracula. You know, Dracula as a character is kind of part of his disturbingness, right, is that he's overtly sexual. There's just no getting around the fact that like the way that you're turned into a monster in that is by being like sensually bit in the neck. Like, there's no getting around it. That's just what it is.
Just all the sound effects that come with that. It's like, who else makes those noises as they're being murdered?
It's totally like this super like Protestant and like hardcore Christian fear of sexuality thing, which spoke to me. Like, I grew up Catholic. And so there is something tantalizing about like being trapped in the Gothic mansion and there are three beautiful women who want to bite my neck. And I'm like a middle schooler who's been raised Catholic. And I'm like, oh no. Like,
So your parents allowed you to watch horror films. Were they super conservative or not really?
No. So it's funny because my dad is a very complicated figure for me religiously. My mom is kind of a lapsed Protestant. It's just not faith isn't super big in her kind of world, which is fine. I've kind of grown into that myself. My dad is very Catholic. You know, I'm half Italian American. His parents are Italian Catholics, and his parents before him. You know, it's this lineage thing. But he's also pretty socially left. One of my formative memories is my church had a pastor who passed away, Monsignor Beatty, who was like the stereotype of like the good Catholic, like just like this overweight like Irish dude with who had the brogue, and he would like tell everyone to just love everyone else, like really the ideal of like this is what Catholicism can be, right?
Yeah.
When you take, I think, the right lessons from it. So this man passes away, and because our diocese is in a very liberal area, the Catholic Church not being quite so left-leaning as our parish, they bring in a more conservative, shall we say, voice of the church. I'm like 12 or 13 in
Okay.
So we're in the sermon, right? It's the middle. They've played the hymns. We're waiting for our snack, you know, we're kind of in that point. And I'm completely checked out, right? Like I'm thinking about whatever 12-year-olds think about. I'm like, when do I get to play Mario next? Whatever. And my dad stands up in the middle of church and he grabs my hand and he says, "We're leaving." And I'm like, I missed something. something's happened here. And my older brother, who's 3 years older than me, had to fill me in afterwards. It's like one of those like quiet car rides on the way home. And I asked my brother, I'm like, I missed something. And he says, the pastor was saying a bunch of really homophobic stuff and dad wasn't having it. And
that's
huge for me.
Great.
For like,
yes,
to have a figure in my life who's like passionate about this community and about his faith, but unwielding in his morality. Like he's not going to sit there and be like, you know, this person represents my faith now. I'm going to let my two kids soak this in. He very pointedly was like, this is not, you know, and he found a different Catholic church in the area. He was like, I'm not doing this. This doesn't represent.
Oh, that's so great for you to be raised in that atmosphere.
Right.
So did you have any pushback or any major hurdles when you realized your own orientation?
I was a late bloomer. I didn't kind of figure out what was going on with me until college, which I think is more common with bi folks who have attraction to, you know, all sorts of different people and bodies, because it's easier to rationalize. Right. Like in high school, I was like, I enjoy looking at other men's bodies because I'm jealous. Not because I enjoy it. Not like, you know, I'm not getting anything out of this, I swear, or whatever. You kind of push down. Right. My parents weren't surprised necessarily. I mean, they really didn't. Like they didn't care in like the best way, you know, like they were like supportive of me. I think my senior year of college, I had come to this realization probably like sophomore, junior year, and I just never really gotten around to coming out to my parents. Most everyone else in my life had kind of done a soft rollout, you know, as I'm kind of accepting it more and more into myself. To walk back briefly here, I should have seen it coming, right? It's one of those things where, like, once you realize it about yourself, everything makes sense. So when I was in high school, I hung out with my school's GSA, Gay Straight Alliance, every Friday.
Oh.
Every Friday. And
wait a minute. When did you graduate? Because how come that even existed? The problem is probably I'm from Georgia, but where were you raised?
That's a big part of it. So I was raised in Bethesda, Maryland, which is one of those like classic upper middle class, like white liberal kind of suburb bubbles where it's like...
Where they have a GSA in high schools.
And actually, Westboro Baptist Church protested at my high school.
Really?
I went to Walt Whitman High School, a.k.a. White Man High School. Unfortunate, but true nickname. And Walt Whitman is thought to be probably queer, right? He's a figure, complicated literary figure, but definitely has some writing in his poetry. So first of all, he's a poet, which is like already, if you're the Westboro Baptist Church, you're like, that's one strike. But like definitely he's thought to be a queer figure. So they came and they picketed with their like, ah, God hates.
So just because of the name?
Right. Because we were named after someone who might be gay.
So ridiculous. I thought it had more to do with the GSA or something.
No, what's amazing is that, you know, the GSA went out and they protested mostly by being a bunch of like out and queer teenagers doing what out and queer teenagers do, which is mostly like hooking up in front of the high school. Like, it's a very weird culture. But so I thought I was the straight person in GSA. I thought I was the only person keeping the alliance together. Without me, the gays would have run amok. It would have
you
been
you just like, oh, right. I'm here doing my part, being an ally.
Yeah, exactly.
Now, in hindsight, was anybody like, yeah, we were just waiting for you to know?
Yeah. So one day I come home. My mom is in the kitchen. I forget. It was just like her turn to cook or something. I don't know why I remember in the kitchen, but it's one of those things where I'm like certain that that's where this happened. And she does, I think, the right thing as a parent, which is very gently. She's like, oh, like, you know, you've been spending a lot of time at the GSA. Like, you know, if you ever needed to talk about any of that stuff, like, I'm here, we're open, like, totally, it would be fine. And like the snooty high schooler I am, I'm like, oh, God, mom, like, I'm not gay. Like, oh, like, how could you even think this about me or whatever? Like, because internalized homophobia is real.
Yeah.
Right? And she says to me, I'll never forget this. She says, are you sure? And so later, you know, I come out in like college and I remember we like went out to dinner and it was like graduation weekend. And I was like, they need to know this about me. Like, this is getting too late in my life. My parents ought to know. And so I'm like, hey, like, you know, I've been thinking about this for a while and just, you know, like I'm bi. And my parents are like, okay.
They just kept eating. Like, they were like, and, oh, right, yeah, they're like, what's happening?
Right. So I don't think anyone was like surprised. I don't know that anyone had anything locked down. Cause again, like I dated very heavily in high school. But I only ever dated women. So I think it was for me, mostly a journey of just figuring out like that what I was feeling wasn't different just because it was of a different body, right? Like that I would be very distracted by someone passing by on the street just because they're a man. That doesn't mean that that feeling is different from when it, and you know,
have you
attracted
had
to women
any problems like finding community within the gay community? Because I know it's an ongoing thing where I hear from cis dudes who are gay and who are only attracted to men that they believe bi men are figuring some things out and that it's this stopping point between bi and, oh, I just realized
the
only
bi-curious
like this one
thing.
But at the same time, I feel like I absolutely know that that is my orientation. And so,
yeah, I'd agree. I think that, you know, my experiences, and I think this is, again, somewhat generational, even like within generations. Like, I think like I'm the tail end of millennials, right? Like that is my, like I'm right at the stopping point. And I think like
in between that
tail,
and Gen Z.
Yes. Yeah. So I think that people on the other end of the millennial spectrum probably have different experiences with this because queer identity kind of exploded in this way that I think everyone was figuring stuff out for a while. And by the time it dripped down to me, there was a fairly codified, like, these are things that we do to take care of ourselves. So among people my age, I've never gotten that.
Oh, that's amazing. That's wonderful.
Because
I'm an old millennial, and on the opposite end, it's a problem.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, for me, like, I have never truly had that set of issues. Now, part of it is that, like, a lot of my friends are bi. So, like, we've kind of already dealt with that, you know? Like, amongst ourselves, we kind of know. But yeah, I mean, the only people I've really ever gotten that from are like, you know, elders, like people that like lived through the AIDS crisis, like people who were kind of in that first wave of really puncturing the hate bubble. Yeah. And, you know, from them, like, it's fine. Like, I'm like, I don't agree with you. But I think that what that generation has that our generation has a different struggle is, I think that generation didn't have as defined categories. Like, you were just, like, you were, if someone called you, you were a queer, you were a goddamn queer, and that's, like, what it was. You mm-hmm. were part of this community because you were being repressed in a very specific way. And I feel like where we're at is in this kind of, there are so many divisions and subdivisions within the acronym. Oh, God bless the big acronym. It gets longer every day because people are trying to find who they are specifically. And I think what'll happen, my theory is what'll happen next generation, is that we will have normalized queerness enough that people are going to start saying, like, well, I don't know if I'm bi or gay or what. I don't know. Yeah. It doesn't matter to me. And I think that that'll probably be a real point of tension for some people, because, like, for me, having a label was really important. So I could say, like, this does define me, right? I can look at this definition and say, like, oh, that's where I fit. But I totally understand people who are like, I don't know. I had a friend in high school who said, well, I know I'm sexual. I just haven't figured out what kind yet. And, like, that always stuck with me. I was like, yeah, that's fair.
Well, like, it's just funny. The more labels there are, then I feel like sometimes I want to reevaluate, oh, is this new box I've become aware mm-hmm. of a better mm-hmm. fit for me? Because yeah. when some people say bi, they mean that they're only drawn to cis people who are male or female. But when I
that's
say
just
it,
transphobia.
I mean,
like,
right?
That's not,
I'm like anybody, any, literally anybody who's funny and who's cute.
Yeah.
It doesn't.
I mean, it's really like, I do find, like, I don't know what your experiences are. Like, I do find that some, and I think that the fine variation between, like, bi and pansexual, like, I find that for me, I do have different, like, qualifications for what makes a woman attractive versus what makes a man attractive. Like, and I don't know exactly why that is. I can't, like, put that into a hat and, like, tell you, like, yeah, I can't break it down in a spreadsheet. But, like, I do, when I find men attractive, I do want them to have, like, a good personality. Like, that doesn't change. But I find myself being attracted to men in a different way than I find myself being attracted to women. And I think that for me, the distinction I've heard between that and, like, pansexual is that pan people are looking for a more unified kind of person across all gender lines. Like, it doesn't yeah. matter. Like, for me, like, it doesn't, you know, it doesn't matter if you're a man, if you're a woman, if you're they, them, if you're genderqueer. Like, if you're a person and you're an attractive person, that's, like, it's all good. Like, it's all fine. But I do think that, and I want to, like, I almost want to defend it because I feel like there's a way that you can say, like, oh, well, doesn't that mean that you view men and women as, like, fundamentally different, like, things? Mm. And I don't think that's true. I think that people end up with different personalities because they're socialized and expected to be different ways.
Absolutely. Because, so I mean, that's with so many things. It yeah. isn't that the differences are inborn. It's all right. about how you're right. socialized.
So, like, for me, when I find what I find attractive in a man is often that, like, they're willing to step aside and, like, not dominate a conversation and, like, not be rude to other people and be aware of their privilege. Like, those are things I find really attractive in men. But I find sometimes the opposite qualities attractive in women, where, like, I find it attractive when a woman is willing to take up space and be like, no, my, like, that self-assurance to know that despite how they're viewed, like, they're going to go out there and kick ass anyway. Like, that's huge for me. And my girlfriend is pursuing, like, a master's degree at Johns Hopkins right now, and she's finding her own path, her own way. We both grew up in, like, really competitive kind of educational environments. We're in those schools where it's like, if you're not getting A's, you're failing.
Yeah.
Right? That kind of pressure. And watching her navigate, like, caring about her work without having it necessarily be, like, about her ego and about her, like, status and all that, like, finding her way in a non-standard field. Like policy analytics is like a non-standard field. That's not one of those STEM fields that we were both brought up to care about. And I find that really attractive about her.
Yeah.
Like, I love that about her, that she's doing these things that are like outside of what she was told was the thing to do. So maybe if there's one thing that unites all the people I'm attracted to, I do love people that are willing to kind of step outside that box.
Yes. I was going to say that that's the connector that I'm
right,
hearing.
That's the through line.
Yeah. Oh, that's fascinating. Well, it is. It's got to be exciting to have a platform where you can focus on your passion or your mm-hmm. like your jam, which is horror, and at the same time use your technical skills
yes.
as someone who has all this experience with audio and in theater. So yeah. How did you get to the point where you realized that you wanted to broaden out in that? I saw in the bio, it looked like COVID might've given you a little push.
Yeah, COVID definitely gave me a push. So I was working as a technical theater person kind of across the board in theater until COVID hit. And the thing about that industry is that it is exploitative. Mm. In this really unpleasant way. Like people talk about like the gig economy. Theater did it first. Like you have to scrap to be employed in theater because you'll be like, you got to structure your whole month like it's a spreadsheet, right? Like I would work 2 days at a theater in Virginia building a set, and then they'd be like, all right, set's done, go home. So then I got to fill the rest of that week with like, all right, I'm striking a set in Maryland, and then I'm going out that weekend and I'm working another 12 hours doing sound mixing at the Atlas Theater or whatever, because I don't know when the work is going to dry up. So because there's no, when you freelance in theater, you're not contracted for long periods of time. So you have to be working as if your job could end tomorrow. Mm. And what happened with COVID was that it did. So I was like, I took a look around and I was like, oh, I hate this. Like this is taking all of my time. And it's hard because I love theater. I love
live performance. Well, I was going to say, why were you drawn to that type of work with, you know, all that pressure that's attached to?
Well, so part of it is that I've been attracted to performance as a subset of like entertainment since as long as I can remember. Right. Like I went to musical theater, like middle school summer camp or whatever. Like I was in that kind of dorky. I played The Wiz. It was a whole thing.
Wait a minute.
Yeah.
They put on The Wiz?
Yeah. Welcome to Bethesda, Maryland,
that,
man.
This
people,
is insane. You are blowing my mind
non-ending. I worked on a production of Once on This Island in a middle school over last summer that was like there were maybe four people in the entire ensemble that were not white, period. And I was like, this is not our story. Like, and it's great is that it's always like junior productions. So you have these like horribly oversimplified like melodies and stuff. And when you're doing stories that are from like a non-Western perspective or that have to do with diaspora, there's a lot of like syncopation and multi-rhythm that gets thrown in there that gets like whitewashed. So like,
it's just like, so funny because like, I'm sure the adults have the best of intentions.
Oh my God, they really want, well, because what they want to do is they want to expose white kids to like non-white media, but then they do it in the whitest way possible. It's like, you have to just, like, there has to be a better way. Anyway. So yeah, I mean, I've loved the performing arts for a long time. Part of that is that I'm dramatic, right? Like I grew up on stand-up comedy. Like I used to stay up way late Friday nights with my older brother, and we would just put on Comedy Central and we'd watch damn comedians. And so there's something about timing and about like the energy that a room has that you can play off of that I find kind of almost like mystical, right? Like you go back to the ancient Greeks and these are religious performances, right? There's something really amazing about just the communication factor. So I've always been fascinated by that. And there's this other thing that specifically technical theater does where it's a support field. And in a lot of the same way that like, the way I imagine like nurses feel about helping be in the medical system and being kind of, you know, they're not the people you think of on the front lines. They're not getting all the accolades, but they're the people making sure those machines are still running. Like,
right.
And that's what technical theater is all about. It's doing the things that no one is going to notice if you do it right. You know, how do you get someone changed backstage in 5 seconds flat so that the audience stays in the world of a show where night and day have just passed and grandma's coming out like she just took off her, in reality, it took her 5 seconds to get out of her evening gown and get into her, like, I'm leaving for the market, whatever. In reality, there's someone back there like unzipping the thing and throwing off the bodice, and someone else is putting on her boots and like, all in service of the illusion of a story. Like, that's what drew me to technical theater, is that it's the backbone of the way that people get lost in stories. So like, that's what it is for me. And podcasting is kind of a natural evolution of that in some ways, because it's a very personal medium. You know, people are putting this in their ears.
Yeah. Oh, I love that. So now that you, what's your vision now? Are you kind of opening up to new possibilities?
Yeah.
Even though COVID gave you the push, do you think this is something that you would prefer to do?
So my plan right now, and actually this is something that I don't think I even put in my, this is like, to pull back the curtain, I got sent like a little form that's like, tell me about your life or whatever. So I am on top of all this podcasting stuff. I'm in progress pursuing a post bachelor's program in speech language sciences. So starting this fall, I'll be studying at the University of Maryland, and I'll be taking a series of courses on kind of the intersection between our language system as human beings and communication disorders and audiology. So like, I just got my textbooks. They're like history of psycholinguistics and like child development problems for speech or whatever. Like, those are
fascinating.
And it's this really specific intersection between what I find really lovely about psychology, which kind of my first academic love, like that was what I really fell for, like in high school, and performance, right? Because all speech is performance, all of it. Like the way that you control your mouth, where you're putting breath, like all of that is a performance. And to me, I think there's something really cool about the idea that in my day job, like, I'll be able to help people communicate more effectively using their bodies, and then hopefully, you know, having a job that's 40 hours a week and not like 65 hours a week, I can still have time for podcasting, which is this kind of media passion of mine. So in the meantime, like, it's going to be this theoretically, right? Like, this is the dream, is that it's going to be this handoff where while I'm at school, podcasting is a way to help me garner some monetary whatever. So I'm doing podcast launch consulting. That's huge for me. I'm doing editing for clients kind of across the board. I'm trying to break into the audio drama realm because that's really where my education is. But, you know, I've edited work, everything from like 5-person panel discussions on how you would beat a movie monster to like monologues about women's fitness. Like, I'm an equal opportunity editor. Some people have like a niche. Like, my niche is people who maybe don't have as much resources or have really specific needs around their like technical environment. Like, that's where I really like to troubleshoot. So the idea is while I'm at school, that stuff can help support me. And then when I have a career in speech language pathology, I can use that to support podcasting. So I'll kind of pass off the torch, is the idea.
Oh, I love that. So what does it look like? Like a day of working as a speech language pathologist? That's what your title would be?
Yeah. So it's really dependent because the field is very, very broad. The vast majority of speech language pathologists go into public school systems as kind of a specific type of caseworker. These are the people that are working with a lot of students on the autism spectrum who might have trouble communicating. These are people that are working with students that have stutters, with students that, for whatever reason, you know, there's so many ways that our language systems can get interrupted. And it's really important in the field that, like, and this is just me starting out, right? Like, these are like the things that are being driven into my head out the get-go. The big thing is that intelligence and language competency are two different things, right? You can be someone who is brilliantly intelligent and has thoughts that are deep and complex and whatever, but you might have a system that's malfunctioning in some way. So for someone with a stutter, it's the literal processes by which your throat and your tongue and your air is working in tandem with how you're trying to communicate a thought. But that doesn't mean that that student is not intelligent or that student does not have the background. You know, I don't want to get too like political, whatever, but it bears mentioning that right now we have a candidate for the presidency, Joe Biden, who has a stutter, grew up with a stutter. And it,
oh, I didn't realize that.
Still, yeah, it's still present. You can hear it. He's worked his entire life to be an orator. And there are still moments where you can hear him catch on a sentence and then go back and get it right the second time. And that is a holdover from his experiences as a child learning how to move past these mental blocks. So it's it informs how people talk about him, though, right?
Oh.
Like, obviously, like, there are things that he said that are just straight up wrong or problematic. Like,
I guess it's the age again.
You know, like, there are, you can organically put your foot in your mouth no matter what, but there are moments that people will show where it's like, oh, like, he's not like functioning mentally, and it's like, no, he has a stutter.
That's not because he's right.
And so you can see that stigma being rolled out on the national level right now. So that's like a big thing for me, is that it's this intersection of like, how do you support the performance? It's the same role.
So it's different from what a speech therapist might do that helps with kids that can't swallow or who are having trouble.
It's the same field, right? Okay. So voice therapy is performance notes, really, when you get down to it. And there are a lot of voice therapists, you know, in the queer world that are working with trans individuals who want their language skills to be more closely in line with how they want to live their lives. Right? It's part of the transition process for a lot of trans folks, especially as you're getting, you know, hormone changes. People who are going on testosterone, like, their voices drop precipitously because their hardware is changing. There are some speech language pathologists who will work with trans folks to say, like, all right, like, you're going through some changes, like, we're going to help you kind of figure out what your new voice is, which is amazing.
Like, yeah. So
for me, I could dork out about it like all day.
It is very, very interesting because I work with a lot of kids who have issues with poor muscle tone related to different genetic disorders that affect the way that they eat. And so I will sometimes turn to communicating with the speech therapist or the pathologist to help with advancing the diet. And so that's kind of the limit of my exposure to it. And once or twice witnessing the horror that is a swallow study with someone who's in a nursing home who doesn't know what's going on. I've like literally never seen anything worse because I recently had a deviated septum corrected, and just feeling like what it's like for people to drop a camera.
So funny you say that. My girlfriend had a deviated septum correction like last month.
The process is gnarly, but being able to breathe is amazing. Like, it's worth it.
Yeah.
But I can't imagine not knowing what was going on as someone was trying to put a camera down your nose. Like, what?
No, it's tough.
Horrifying.
But there's something very visceral about our speech systems because they are so complicated. Right? Like, people don't think about the fact that, like, you're not just talking your vocal cords, you're talking about your, like, air intake, you're talking about your sinuses, like, literally how the sound is resonating through your head has to do with how your sinuses are laid out. You're talking about your tongue. Your tongue is a huge, complicated organ that, like, is this massive thing in your face that, like, people don't think about how big your tongue is. Like, look up, like, a cross-section of someone's tongue. It's huge.
It's disturbing. It's funny truly because terrifying. I generally like anatomy and physiology, but when I was learning, just, like, how deep is this passage?
Right.
It just weirded me out. I'm like, how far are you going? Like, this is just insane.
Yeah, I do think that there is some sort of weird cosmic connection between being really into horror and being really into the weird anatomy that makes up. Like, there's something eldritch about the way that speech works. You've got like a tentacle flapping around in your mouth.
Yes, you know, that is a good connection, because it, the human body is just so bizarre in so many ways.
Messed up. I, like,
fascinating, listen, and disgusting at the same time. Like, I really was just blown away by, I don't know if you've had to be screened for COVID yet, but just
not yet. The brain tickler, they're like, did you get the one that way go? Well, okay, so if you're doing this on video, so I'll try to describe this as I'm doing it for those of you that aren't viewing this on video, but if you take your hands, you put them kind of right at the base of where your ears are, right where your kind of thing connects there,
right there,
okay. Your dangly dudes, you know, these things, the pinna. That is about as far in as they need to go.
That's ridiculous.
So if you take your thumb and put it there, and then you take your pinky and put it on the tip of your nose, and you take that away from your face, that little hang 10 sign is how deep they gotta
that's
put.
That's definitely what it felt like.
And yeah, like, they go in.
It's so ridiculous, because I'm considered essential, which I think is a bit of a, it's a little bit of a sham, but whatever.
A stretch, you say.
Exactly. Yeah. So I work at a school system in the nutrition department. There are no kids there. There's nobody eating. I'm always doing planning, and I'm just in my office. And literally everything I do there, I could do in my home office. But for whatever reason.
Kafka-esque nightmare to be in a planning field right now.
Oh my goodness. First, they said we need you to create a full plan like they wanted. Charts, they wanted graphs, like, what are you gonna do if they do come back? What are you gonna do if they don't come back physically? What will you do if we decide to stagger the students? What? And I just want to be like, I don't want to do any of this. I'm living through a pandemic too. Tell me when you figure out what you're doing, and then I'll come back to
also
the office.
Like, yeah, let me just pull down my like crystal ball here. Let me get out the tarot cards and see.
It's exactly what they're asking for.
It's 2020, baby. Like, there's no predicting what's happening.
Exactly.
Here.
All we know is it's a dumpster fire. Like that. And as soon as you think things can't get any worse, you will be corrected. That's the only thing I've learned this year. But it's crazy. We keep getting exposed. So I think I've gotten 5 tests now. And I am not a fan. I am not a fan. I've been such a baby about it. Like, I cough the
whole
time.
I'm going to do the math here, right? Like, this has to be like 6 or 8 inches, which you've done 5 times. You've got like 3 to 4 feet.
Of torture.
Yeah, of Q-tip pushed through your face. Here's a fun pro tip. If you don't want a Q-tip pushed to the back of your gullet, maybe just stay inside for a while. Yeah.
There you go. Stay home, everybody. Well, you know, Georgia is doing like the worst job with COVID. We've decided, well, I didn't realize that everyone had made this decision, but they don't like science around these parts. I didn't really notice that until now. And yeah, I guess that's the end of this story. That's the
because I lived out in Maryland for a bit, and I'm living in D.C. now, and Maryland's weird because they have a Republican governor who is pretty much as far left as Republicans get these days. And so he's been more or less behaving like a Democratic governor, in that, like, we've had a state shutdown, like we've been really drawing down on testing. There's been like mask ordinances and stuff.
So he's not a COVID denier, which apparently
denier, which is huge. But what's interesting is watching the amount of pressure that he's under to reopen the state from his base, right? Because like his base is buying into a lot of the rhetoric around it being safe, and it's not. Like, it's not safe. And it's hard because you can watch this guy who's really doing his best to represent the people who elected him, but also to keep their best interests in mind. You can see him in real time dealing with the misinformation and figuring out, like, all right, like, what can I reasonably open up for my base, right? Like, it's a purely political whatever. It's heartbreaking to watch.
Really difficult situation. It's funny, like, it makes me think too of your dad having the backbone to say something when a larger group that he belongs to say something that didn't resonate and what he knew was pure foolishness and getting up and moving on. So yeah, there are all these people who are, they're not monsters, but they're, you have to be strong to be able to go your own way.
There's so much misinformation out there right now. That's what breaks my heart. Is it like, it really bothers me. You know, I went to school in Vermont, and it is true. Like, there's a lot of Yankee resentment of Southern states. And I grew up in Maryland, which is literally like, that's the Mason-Dixon line. Like, that is right there. And so to be this kind of middle child.
I didn't even know there was Yankee resentment of Southern states. All I know is what we say down here.
No. Yeah, there's like some real, well, because there's this thing where the North is convinced that all Southerners are crazy and ignorant. Like,
well, it's not looking good right now.
The problem is that the reason why that happens is that you have communities that are severely under-resourced, mm-hmm. and are being fed and have been fed misinformation about their own history for decades, if not centuries, right? And that's happening right now, and you're seeing the public health effects where people are being given a very specific subset of ideas and rhetoric, and it's endangering their lives for bottom lines, like it's money.
Yeah, exactly.
And it's hard because, like, what happens is that the people who are far enough removed from it geographically look at people who are down south and think, like, look at these rubes, these individual idiots who are behaving poorly. And it's just like it ignores this whole context of being like, well, if you were under assault from misinformation 24 hours a day your entire life, you might hold some ideas that are counterproductive.
Like, well, what's so bizarre is when you're down here, and I'm from here, and I am shocked. I am legitimately surprised by the amount of people in my life that are essentially COVID deniers. I literally taped up the chair in my office. One, you know, you never move your office chair because someone will swap it out for a chair that's got a bad wheel. So I said,
the one that squeaks or whatever.
Exactly. Yeah. I said, I'm not going to fall for that. It's staying in this office. But no one can sit in here. When I first went back to work, because I stayed out for maybe a full 3 months working from home because I'm not crazy. And then when I realized, this is going to drag on forever, and work was basically saying, for some reason, we need to see you. Get back here. Yeah. I had to tell people, like, I don't know, what are you thinking? When they would come to my office and get ready to plop down in the visitor's chair, I'm like, you're out of your mind. I put a little X on the floor, like literally 12 feet from me. I'm like, that's as far as you need to go. I can see you from there. But I eventually had to just tape up the chair because I'm like, you will not be forgetting this again. Mm-hmm. And I don't want to have to make too much of a scene, but people so don't take it seriously. People took pictures of it. They posted it on Facebook.
Yeah, they're like, look at this crazy paranoid person. Yeah, it's hard. It's hard.
It's bizarre.
It's like, but I think, you know, you're doing kind of the Lord's work out there in that, you know, people know you and they assume it. And I'm going to assume that you're a reasonable human being. That's maybe not... You know, based
I
on
definitely
one conversation.
Think I am. If nothing else, I absolutely believe that COVID is real. Like, bare minimum.
Right. So that, like, bare minimum. And it's important, though, to, like, model behavior in a non-judgmental way. Right? Like, no one has ever had their mind changed or being yelled at. Yeah. And that being said, policies have been changed by yelling at the government. Like, we should absolutely yell at the government, but we should probably not yell at our neighbors. Right? Like, I think that's really a big thing right now, and especially coming from a queer perspective, right? Like, there are a lot of ideas about what kind of person is queer, and I think that right now there are a lot of ideas on both sides of the aisle about what kind of person either believes or doesn't believe the science around the coronavirus. And the problem is that there are all types of people on both sides.
Yeah, that is
all
true.
Types of people, and we can't deal with a public health crisis in this way from a place of judgment. We just can't do it.
Yeah.
And it breaks my heart because, like, I know a lot of people have to blow off steam. You know, when people endanger themselves and others in a way that is selfish, you have to blow off steam. But you also have to, I think something I've been working on a lot during this has just been, like, keeping empathy in my heart, you know?
Yeah.
It's hard.
That's
it's
a big hard.
And I don't always succeed.
Well, I think that's kind of the key, though, for your own peace of mind.
Mm-hmm.
It's not even just because that's a more effective way to communicate, but we have to understand that in the end, the only person you really have any control over is yourself. So, well,
it's heartbreaking to view the world as if everyone on the other side of this political line is a monster.
Yeah.
You know, if I believed that everyone who voted for Donald Trump, who I did not vote for, like, I'll be honest about it. I'll be open about being pretty far to the left, even like as a Democrat, like, for like my choice would have been Warren, right? Like, I'm not quite so far left as some people, but like, I'm by far would never have voted for President Trump. And if I were to believe that everyone who did is a capital B bad person, it would crush me like a can on the bottom of the ocean. Like, I would be devastated, because like, those people are my family, right? Like,
how
many like degrees of separation do you need to go to get out of your political bubble? For me, it's like one or two.
Yeah. But, I mean, it's bananas being here, because it literally, I'm related to Trump supporters. Mm-hmm. I won't identify them, even though they're still super proud of it. And I mean related by marriage. These are not black people. Right. Say. But
they exist. I mean, there are a few of them.
That's true. That's true.
They show up to every campaign rally.
Oh, please. Like, some of those people, I don't know if you've ever seen, man. But literally you can see, because he visits Georgia, in my opinion, a lot. I don't know if it really is a lot. It seems like a lot. But they hire people and they list the ads. They're on Craigslist. I'm sure there are other places too. And, you know, if you are homeless and somebody says, I'll give you $100 to stand behind this podium and smile and wear this MAGA 100%. Shirt, you're like on board. Like, you have to secure the bag. Yeah. Like, yeah, there's really no time for you to be worried about what is this going to do to other people of color. You gotta eat, right? So they're targeting vulnerable people. I'm sure there are some people who legitimately do support him are black that aren't mentally ill, maybe, because I'm not counting Kanye, because poor thing, he himself has said, like,
people stopped saying no to Kanye. Like, I don't know that anyone said no to him in the last 10 to 15 years.
Well, he doesn't listen, and he said he doesn't feel like himself on his medication, which, okay, fine, like, that's a whole separate issue. But thank you for
a psychiatrist.
I know, right? But at least thank you for openly letting us know.
Did you see him dragging Harriet Tubman? I'm sorry.
Oh my god.
Back up. I try not to cut celebrity gossip, but like, like, that is the most, a lot of buck wild things have happened in 2020, but someone being like, you know who didn't do enough for the cause? Harriet Tubman.
Whoever. What? Again, this all seems like absolute fiction, but I like that at least he's put it out there that he's not well. He knows should be medicated. He hasn't found the medication for him. So why anybody would be Kanye West likes him. He's unwell. He's not representative.
I can't wait for the Kanye West biopic. That's what I want. I want
it
yesterday.
It would be fascinating. He really is an interesting person, but I feel like ever since his mom passed, he's really been struggling.
I want to know his story. Like, I want to know like what led him to go from a truth teller to not that. Like,
yes, and I would love to know how much of that is a function of the mental illness, and where is the Kanye we first met?
Celebrity. Like, yes. You know, like when you have that much money, if I had the amount of money that Kanye West has, and I were to say to anyone walking down the street, like, you know, I've been having some thoughts about Harriet Tubman, how many of those people would be like, you're wrong? Not many.
Yeah, that's true.
You know, like, if, in my inner circle, if I had, like, all that clout, all that money, all that power, like, and I said something kind of iffy, how many people would stand up to that? Not many.
Well, it's so interesting because he's gone so far beyond iffy. Mm-hmm. Remember when he said slavery was a choice? I'm just like, get help, my dear.
Can't stop it.
Like, we're praying for you.
You are playing into the oppressor. Like, you've got to
But to an insane extent. Like,
it's really cartoonish extent.
It really is. So it's
straight
just
out of the Boondocks. Like,
oh, absolutely.
Unreal.
Thank you so much for coming on. Where can people catch your show? And if someone is ready to launch a podcast, or, you know, who wants to work with a queer person who can really help them clarify their message, where do they find you?
So my hobby podcast, which is the Stephen King comedy podcast, is me and a buddy. We are the Stephen King Boo Club. That's B-O-O exclamation point. You can find us all over the place. What's convenient about that name is that if you plug Stephen King into your podcatcher of choice, it should pop up pretty quickly. We're the ones with the clown and the cartoonish vampire. That's us in your podcatcher. That's Stephen King Boo Club. Personally, my work can be found at indrisanoaudio.com. Now, that's an Italian name, so I'll spell it for you. That's I-N-D as in David, R-I-S-A-N-O audio.com. I do podcast launch consulting. That's huge for me because there's so much stuff to consider. I do podcast editing if you're looking to upgrade your sound. And I also do intro, outro music if you want some specific branding for your show.
Now, I saw that and the rate was like super affordable. Yeah. Do you have demos posted anywhere?
I'm working on putting together that part. I do have a portfolio page on the website. I'm putting together like one final intro for a local news program right now. And then when that goes up, I will have that there. But if you have any questions, you can email me at indrisanoaudio@gmail.com. So if you're looking for a quote, if you just have some questions, I'm on Twitter. Like if you need audio stuff figured out and you can't afford it, that's fine. Like, I'm always around for just like small answers and stuff. This is a real like passion point for me. I've been a podcast fanatic since like, I don't know, 2005, whenever Knife Point Horror entered my world.
Yeah, you're really in there. Well, and then too, I think because you're a digital native, that makes sense.
Mm-hmm. So I've been with it pretty much as long as iTunes has supported podcasting. So it's not just, you know, the years that I've done doing it. It's the years that I've spent consuming just like hundreds of hours of this stuff. So it's a real passion point for me. And in fact, I met Dahlia. I've never pronounced your name out loud. Dahlia?
I'm
realizing. Dahlia. All right. Nice to meet you, Dahlia, at the end of this here episode.
Same here.
I met Dahlia at a podcasting conference. Like,
well, it's so funny. That was really, really good. Well, what drew me to you was, I don't even remember what you said, but you were like, yeah, bi pride. And I'm like, yes, because you're in an LGBTQ podcasting group and throwing the bi pride up there. And it probably resonates with me even more because I'm an old millennial. I was like, wow, look at that. Putting it out there.
I'm proud.
Look at the kids
for
go.
Sure, for
yeah.
Sure.
Said, oh, we definitely need to connect.
The pleasure has been all mine. You know, if I can do anything for you or your folks, you know, obviously let me know.
Thank you so much.
Happy to be on the program. This has been an absolute delight.
All those links will be in the show notes, everybody. Awesome.
Signing off.
Oh, fantastic. Let me actually hit stop on this other one.